I've gotten a lot of questions over the years of the channel about what I have actually in my solo RPG wallet, and I had some requests to go through it, and I'm going to do that here in this brief video. You'll note that I pull stuff out of here during videos to basically answer essentially the yes or no kinds of questions, and you'll also note if you watch the channel with any frequency that I tend not to use any elaborate emulators, or I'll use, like the fate chart from Mythic or whatever. It's not really the style of play that I have. I tend to get so involved in the emergent fiction of what's happening that I guess I just don't really need much more sometimes than a direction on a yes or a no. It's a style thing. It's not a judgment thing. So you'll find in the context of my channel that a lot of what I'm doing is just really, really basic. And in terms of a type of sort of emulator or response, I haven't made use of all the great resources that are out there, like the Game Master's Apprentice deck and things like that. I have it, and I just find sometimes that the more direction I'm given, the less creative I feel. That's just, I guess, the way that I roll. This, what we're looking at here, I don't remember where I got it. I do remember it was the very first thing that I ever had, this percentile table. And along the way, over the years, I found it again with a different orientation, and I printed that out just because if I'm using something where I have a lot of horizontal cards, I'll take this one, or vertical, I'll take that one, just to basically have it match. I do like to use cards in the games that I play. When I do sessions, I'll make cards just using index cards, and I like the context of flipping through things. I'll put little character sheets on cards if I can. This is the board gamer in me, I think, coming out when I'm doing any type of solo RPG work. So this is just an extremely basic table. What is useful to me about it visually is that first of all, I love a D100 roll. And second of all, because it's laid out in this linear fashion, I just get this visual sense somehow. I ascribe to the numbers here as if it was like those old bar graphs that you have in school, and it kind of helps me with the language, understanding the likelihood. And so overall, you know, if I had to only choose one thing to get me through any type of anything, it would be this. So that's the first thing here in the wallet. The next thing here, and again, I put it in an order here just for discussion purposes of the video, but it's not in any kind of order in the wallet. This, I don't remember where this comes from. I'm sure somebody will recognize it, and I apologize for not having the credit. So in the comments, you can make a note of that if you remember. This is what's interesting to me here is two things, and I include this as a reminder to myself, because oftentimes I will even forget just to kind of roll on a table to get a yes or a no. But this idea, envision two options, rate one as likely and roll on the table below to see if it is true. If not, it is the other. This is great to remember, and a good piece of advice to give, that when you are going to a table to try to get a yes or a no question, I've talked about this across the channel, that sometimes you get stuck. It's like you keep going back and going back to a table and rolling on it because it's like you're not getting the answer you want, or you're not really given a direction. That even if you have even if you're rolling on something that gives you more of a like a kind of a but and sort of thing, sometimes you need a little bit more than that. And this is a great reminder, instead of just rolling on the table, come up with, before you roll, two actual narrative strands, that if it's this, this will happen. If it's that, this will happen. And do it that way, and that may yield something. So this is another D100 table, and the odds are described this way. The other reason I have all these tables is, as you'll see as we go through it, the language used in the describing the outcome slightly differs. And sometimes I will feel that one is more applicable, or one seems to make more sense, or one is more granular than the other. So here we're going to look, and I'm taking all the, obviously you can see why these are always out of order. This is a D20 table. I think this comes from the D20 rules. I can't remember the name. I'm sorry about that. This comes from, this has the D20 options here. So you have more granularity in describing this. And when I'm involved in a story and storytelling, I do have these feelings. So it's like the difference between, is it slightly more likely or is quite likely? That actually can be a difference, for example, that I would feel. Or it's like definitely likely or very likely. Looking at the chart like this out of narrative context may seem ridiculous because the difference in percentage is so little. But being involved in a story, one does gravitate toward these nuances. And that's why I have all these different things in the wallet, because I'll just flip through them to see what makes sense, what feels like the right question to be asking. And I think the more you feel that something is right, the more it's integrating into the story, the more it is really emergent from the story as opposed to imposing some kind of choice on the story. And along the same lines here with this D20, we have these outcomes, and these are useful because they give a teeny bit of narrative direction to what is going to happen next with a no, or what is going to happen next with a yes. So I like this D20 option just for the variety that it offers and the nuance, the narrative nuance that it offers. These, I do remember where they come from. These come from Scarlet Heroes, these three. You've seen these before. This is the general oracle. And again, we're getting here, this is less nuanced, but we have the no but and the yes but here. And then we have a 1d6 roll for the complication and the explanation of that complication. This, again, having that slight carry over into the next paragraph if you're thinking about writing, or when a great academic advisor of mine told me during the context of writing my dissertation, you know, stop when you know what your next few pages are going to be. Stop at the beginning of the next paragraph. And this is essentially what this is doing. It's giving you the next sentence. It's giving you the next scene, and having this can be a way of avoiding the rut of this, you know, it's just like the yes-no rut, basically, where you're trying to get some direction. And this is when you're doing solo RPG work, of course, this is the biggest challenge. It's that moment from going, I think of it as the moment from when you're involved as being the player to when you are needing to switch over to be the GM. That transition can be super difficult, and things like this will take you through that transition. This also comes from Scarlet Heroes and is pretty useful. Recently I used it. Again, it can be actually useful in terms of if you're in the same room or if you are doing some type of overland thing, or it can just be conceptually useful. I used this in a video recently where neither of these exactly described the distance. It was a kind of an urban thing, but I rolled on it and attributed that direction in the context of what I was doing to be that something was a few streets away. So this is useful if you are working within an environment in this kind of three-dimensional way. And then we've got here, this is a D20 roll. I also used this fairly recently with the modifiers here, and this gives a less granular answer. It's just a yes, no, or a maybe, but it is useful when you want less direction. And sometimes I do want less direction, and sometimes also, like everybody, I just want to roll a D20. So I find myself using this one quite a bit. And here is just another version. It's a D6 roll of various types of yes-no answers. This is a very, very basic kind of monster or NPC or enemy reaction table. most of the those kinds of things that I use come from books. And of course, I should say, I probably should have said at the outset that the majority of other types of random tables that I would use, whether it's a monster reaction or a creation of environment or the weather or the terrain, these kinds of things come from books. I have many different books, some of which you've seen over the course of the channel. Maybe I'll do yet another video on some of my favorite random tables in books, but there's a wealth of material that cannot be contained in something like this wallet. Really, what this wallet is for is the most generic kind of yes or no question or narrative push to a story that's happening. And then the final two cards, I don't really use these very much. They're just more conceptual because they come from specific, they would really only work with a specific rule set, is how to get a difficulty class and how to understand a success and what that could mean. And again, I'm blanking right now on where this is from. I think this is from the master book. I'm not totally sure. But I keep them in here because they... Well, first of all, I could scale them to whatever I'm doing if I need something specific like that. But more, it's really just a reminder that when you get, say, a yes or a no, in addition to giving things like what the complication might be or something along these lines, it's important, I think, to think of the larger conceptual success or failure of something in the course of your narrative and what can become challenging sometimes for me is the balance between getting so specific into the mechanics and the scene and also remembering the bigger picture, especially if there is some suggestion of a world that I am in or that my characters are in or larger forces at work that are just sort of abstractly sketched out but form the background and form the context for the story, which adds richness, of course. And so things of this nature can remind me that, particularly this one, I think in the larger context, you can attribute that to how successful your characters are in operating in the larger world outside of the particular scene. So there's a look inside the solo RPG wallet of Geek Gamers, and I keep this handy all the time, and frankly, I could just take this and a couple of dice and just make up some game, but it is, I like the fact that, well, I'll say at the end here, this is a wallet of mine. This is the first wallet I ever bought with my own money, and I've had it forever. It's been a favorite, and I had to retire it because it just was falling apart. I used to take it out maybe 1 week, a year, just to use it because I liked it. And then I found a use for it where I can use it more than that. And it's something also about the kind of the visceral feeling of this, like pulling this out gets me thinking about the duality of being both a player and a GM and how to manage that for myself and how this is really the source of that transition that allows ultimately for the more seamless play and the fuller involvement that I can have as the story develops.